Bev Bisbee and Joanne Paquette, who have put together a presentation and want to talk about laptops for us. And one of the things that I think is important throughout their presentation and the things that they will talk about is to remember that the laptops, however they're done, you know, whether they're done through the state, whether they're done through our own funding, whatever the final decision will be, it really is about a future investment for the kids. It's not about today. It's not about these 7th and 8th graders that have been testing them out for the past couple of years. Because these guys are the kids that will lead the rest of the kids coming up through the ranks. And what this is about is teaching the teachers. And the kids don't need to learn. It's the teachers that we need the professional development time for, because the laptops are all about teaching and learning tools and not necessarily about the technology. And several of the newspaper articles that have been out there lately, like there was one that I read where a parent had said, well, you know, it's not that important to me. I have an 8th grade student. It's not that important to me because we have 4 computers in our house. So she was saying it wasn't important whether her child had a laptop or not. But it's not about the computer. It's about a different way of learning and a different way of our teachers to teach. And it's not, the whole technology thing, it's here. I mean, it's not going to go away. There's no going back. And I think this is the future of where we're headed. And I think that's what Bev and Joanne will bring to us tonight. So we're going to start here. And I think they want everyone to move up to these chairs over here. And we'll hear our presentation. And then as soon as they are finished, we'll start with our budget.
The next portion of this workshop has to deal with directly with the budget. It deals with the reductions that this leadership team has come up with. Remember the last time we met with the school board about the budget, we made our initial presentation at our all-day Saturday. We received input that we need to make some reductions. The school board at that time was pretty clear that they wanted, rather than 12.5% increase on the expense side, the budget get closer to 10%. What we have before you is a list of the areas that have been reduced from the original proposal to the tune of $406,000, and which constitutes a 9.84% increase over last year's budget. So there was a significant reductions made budget in several different areas, and I'd like to just go through these, and as I do, the administrators can answer any questions regarding what the cuts are. We met with the finance subcommittee, Pauline and I went through the cuts in some detail. We spent a couple of hours going through all of these. It's not our intent to take that much of your time, but we do want to make sure you're clear on what the areas. Since we presented this. And they're set up right now by Pine Cove Middle School, High School, and district-wide. I know there was another, Pauline put together another sheet that had the specific lines where these came from. So this is just to give you some information about what kinds of things that you saw before in the budget and not there anymore. I'll start with Pine Cove. If you remember, there was a request for an additional ed tech code, and this was the request that Tom Heisman had made to deal with some issues with regular education, that they needed some assistance in classrooms. It was something that was going to be preventative, to hopefully work with some of the students at a younger age so that maybe prevent some special education issues down the road, some other costs. But something that we don't have now, we felt that we could do without. There was also a request for an additional halftime guidance position. This has been part of our five-year staffing plan for 5 years. And because of a lot of the needs that are there in Pine Cove, there has been a request over the last several years to increase guidance. But that's left out of this budget. And the last piece of Pine Cove is furniture. As you know, we have a furniture replacement program that's tried to continually replace furniture. With the last building project, there was no new furniture included in that project. It was supposed to be something that we took care of in the ensuing budget, so we've been doing that in the last several years. We're cutting it back, so this is another year we're going to cut back to some furniture. So the building project, the furniture for the kindergarten is part of the project, so we will have that. But we will be utilizing, as you know, all 28 classrooms at Pine Cove next year. So all the classrooms will be utilized at Pine Cove. So furniture becomes something that's important. But we'll get by, let me get without replacement. But again, that was a point in time we can't do that anymore. Questions?
Is the furniture, is that three classrooms of furniture? Is that what was taken?
That 3,500, that's just one.
So
we took out one, we still have two in there?
Yeah.
We still have two.
So we have two aside from the kindergarten?
Now one is pretty good, it's a very good school, because right now it's the classroom that's the
OT.
OT, yeah. Which has the application therapy. And I don't think we've had 20 classrooms occupied.
Three or four years ago, probably. It's been a while.
Questions on Pine Cove?
Yeah.
Do
you want all questions?
No, go ahead.
I'm a little concerned about the ed tech thing, in that my assumption was that if we were to have this position, that ultimately that would be a cost savings down the road, being that it's a preventive measure rather than a, any idea what those costs, I mean, I think that, you know, it's like regular medical insurance where nobody pays for preventive health care and are willing to pay for all kinds of catastrophic,
yeah.
You know, I'm just wondering if this is penny wise and dollar foolish or not. And
it's a hard question to answer. In the academic arena, you know, we can gather data
right.
Over time with the recovery and other kinds of programs.
Right. But you're right, Jen, these are things that are not going to happen. So it's hard to document that.
Okay. So just no ballpark at all on what you're...
If they were clear, what would be your estimate?
Well, weren't our conversations at church, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
I think you're going to have some kids that their needs are going to go unmet. If they're a student with an adult, is that with a disability? And have some behavioral issues that if they need a behavior plan that has to be implemented with an adult, it's going to be difficult to do, more difficult to do. The impact, that's hard to measure until.
Just from experience, you know. Sort of using somebody
in
the last year,
right? I went back and looked at current student population at TAT, so my estimate now is probably 10 kids a year with would benefit from something like that. Out of those 10 kids, you know, speculating one or two could be special education, right? Would that be reasonable? Might be forced in that direction and probably shouldn't be, is my opinion. And that's pricey for referrals and other therapies. So, am I on the right track, Claire?
I think what you're going to find is you're going to have referrals to special education, and they're going to be evaluated. And if they don't present with a disability, they won't be identified.
Right.
And I think for me, the concern that I've always had is that period of time that their needs are not being met. But we had to cut someplace, and you know,
right.
We've got to look at what is there.
It comes down to, in all of these, obviously, there's a
right.
Well, I realize that, but
it, as Tom said, it's less painful because we don't have one yet.
I think you'll probably see that transition to be coming into the budget every year.
Right.
Because I think ideally, somewhere down the road, we may want to do something that can happen.
Okay.
Thank you.
At the middle school, when the budget was first presented, Nancy presented several options regarding her original request about Allied Arts. And one of the main purposes for this was, as you know, schools are required to create local assessment systems. Middle school has the least amount of collaborative time, which is zero. So all their work needs to be done at other times. And it's just very difficult to get that network done. The local assessment system needs to be in place. This was an attempt by adding Allied Arts. Obviously, when kids are in school, someone has to be doing something with those students. At the middle school, it's the regular classroom teacher at all times. There isn't that time available. As in high school, students can be in study hall, their classes rotate, their kids take several different classes. There was an opportunity a couple of years ago by hiring the study hall monitors to gain collaborative time with high school teachers in a rather inexpensive way. At the middle school, they would take bringing in more Allied Arts, which is, by the way most middle schools do that. We are, compared to other middle schools in the area, understaffed as far as Allied Arts. Offer the number of Allied Arts and time in Allied Arts that most of the schools do. So that takes away that collaborative time. Nancy's proposal, instead of $76,000, would be for next year we have to add some more late start days to the schedule. There's disadvantages to that. The advantage is the work can get done. The disadvantage is that it takes away from convenience for parents. If we have a regular scheduled early release, late start time, our feeling is that the teachers, they have that 90 minutes of time to work together, to collaborate, to create the local assessments, and then the work will get done. At least financially, it will be expensive. There are some other processes. Let me go through the rest of the middle school, and then Nancy is here to answer the questions. Sarah also has local assessments. We've cut some money out of music equipment. Remember, there was a request for some, I think that's the guitars for the music program. With the testing program, if the state is going to be testing grades 3 through 8, we thought we'd cut back on some of the testing that we do. There was a request for Inspiration software. It's very good software. Request for 7th and 8th grade, we pared that back in half so that we could phase it in over 2 years. And point two for the language teacher addition was also cut back. So Nancy, I don't know if you want to add anything about the Allied Arts, anything about the language or any of those other things that you feel they should know.
Yeah, sure, I'll just, I think Tom's covered it very well. If you remember from our Saturday workshop, one of the proposals was for those late start days. We've worked with that. We've given a thought to the calendar committee on that and just working that out. It works out to about 2 per month. They are not every other week. We've really tried to move around shortened weeks and kinds of things because the big opportunity cost of the late starts is instructional time. And if you remember from the proposal, I explained to you that in team leaders we had gone through so that on those days that we do come in 90 minutes later, all of our classes will meet. They'll just meet for a shortened amount of time, for 35 minutes, so teachers can plan and everything can be consistent and continuous in our study. Actually, the release time, an advantage of that is that all of our teachers will be free at the same time so that we can have content-specific meetings, we can have grade-level meetings, and we can have cross-grade-level meetings. So we think we're going to get a great deal of return as we work on our local assessments. We give them, we score them, we refine them, we go out and we give them again, or we do the next part for our certification processes for learning. So we think it will be a good solution to that, and we're trying to organize the day so it will have the least impact on learning as possible. And the other things I think we had, those are pretty much just like everybody else is looking at the CATs. We were cautious when we put that in anyway, but then because we weren't sure where the state testing was, and we really do feel the state testing will very adequately take place on the California Achievement Test, and everything we hear is those are going to be ready to go and everyone is going to be expected to give them next year. So we aren't losing anything there. We just weren't sure when we first put the budget together if we really were going to get them, but it does appear that we are, so we feel that that can come out of the budget without losing anything.
Question about the middle school? With regard to the high school, as you know, the enrollment in the high school is going up another 40 to 50 students. The original request, I'll let Jeff, when I get through the rest, and explain how we got down to being able to increase the request for teachers. But we'll play the numbers a little bit more closely. And we were able to reduce that original request by 1.3 teachers. Some smaller reduction in natural health with dues and fees, and I think that money was going to come from.
We were hoping to sort of put that in as a regular budget item so it wasn't continually dependent on a grant, but we're just hoping, assuming that it will continue through the grant.
Okay. Furniture, a significant reduction in furniture from the original request. There will be, we do need furniture for portable classrooms. We will need furniture when the kindergarten vacates, so we have significant furniture needs. But within all of that, we're trying to find some furniture to equip some other rooms. Again, taking a look at these library tables, we're able to reduce that by $10,500. Stage curtain is in need of repair. It's expensive. For another year, get by with that, take a reduction in athletics of $6,000, which would be within the lines that they have now, maybe different areas in athletics, not from one program, moving from one team versus another team, it might be a little bit more, it might be something.
Coach that was requested was taken out, a ninth grade girls basketball, some coaches' conferences, hockey security, which will be picked up hopefully by boosters, and conferences. So we come out of, well, basically a new request.
Wayne, what were the new requests? Wasn't that around $5,000 or something?
It's listed here as the $6,000. cut out of the whole budget, yeah, the whole budget was up 17, which was the 4%.
His whole budget was up $17,000?
17,847 for an increase of.
And so, and.
4.35.
So now his budget will be up by $11,000, you're saying?
And most of it now would be, I think, contracted increase in purchase salaries.
And what was the original increase in teachers?
Original, the proposal originally was 4.
Or full-time? 4.0.
Full-time equivalent.
Yeah.
Be a little bit of this and a little bit of that in some areas, but it would add up, it would have added up to 4.
And so by taking out 1.3, I guess you're just kind of shuffling that around where the priorities would really lie with population, student population.
I'm making sort of a prediction based on a hope that the signups will
go a certain.
Cut in a certain way so that, we can end up with slightly larger class sizes in some places without overdoing the total teacher load.
So do you feel that figure is really workable for the teachers and what impact?
I think it is.
Teacher load and classroom size significantly?
I think it is. I'll let you know if it isn't, but I think it is. We're getting the numbers in. We have an 8th grade open house tomorrow, at which time we'll have a pretty good handle on the electives, which are the wild card, really. I mean, the other things, the core classes are fairly predictable, but it's really the elective areas. The unknown at this point is the 9th graders and electives, and we're hopefully picking up most of those numbers tomorrow, so I'll be able to fairly quickly say, yeah, this is something that we can do. But I feel reasonably comfortable with this. I would rather do this. This is what we can do.
Does this number influence what you were hoping to do with the Learning Center?
I'm still hoping, but again, it really is very dependent on numbers and where the cut points are and break points. I'm hoping that we can have one period for an English teacher and one period for a math teacher and have that be the same period where all the 9th graders, as they were this year, are together in a through a more structured study hall. So it would be at least a beginning of being able to address the highest priority needs and to make it accessible to at least all the 9th graders, regardless of what happens with this year's 9th graders, which we're still not certain about next year's, will face the requirement of the learning results and graduation requirements and things. So I'm hoping it's enough that we can really pilot and collect some data, figure out if it's going to be used, and support kids.
Before we go on to district-wide, I wanted to share with you a conversation we had about class size. That's something that's important to us. We really try to hold to school board policy on class size. And as you know, the area where we are over most is at middle school. The 7th and 8th grade caseloads at the middle school are well over the recommended 80-90 students per teacher. Sometimes 110 to 150 students per teacher. We also took a look at what the class sizes were for the incoming 5th grade and made decision that this would be a good year to address the 7th and 8th grade issue, to try to do something about reducing those caseloads to get at least a bit closer to 100 per teacher rather than 10 to 15, and if we can do it even in one or two subject areas, that would be helpful. So what we decided to do at the middle school was to sacrifice one 5th grade teacher, which would bring those class sizes right about what the requirement is, so one less 5th grade next year, but to add that, to reallocate one of those teachers to the 7th grade. That does bring those loads down to about 102, 104.
102, 104.
So it's just taking a look at the resources that we have, and, you know, there is an argument, it's probably a discussion for a later day about, you know, where the priority is, and Nancy will give a great argument about that, because this fifth grade is a big transition year, which I think is important to have, reasonable class size, maybe a smaller to fifth grade than some of the other middle school grades. But we also felt it was important to honor the policy. We have a policy, and the policy, you know, was written for a reason. So where was the weakness in the policy? Where were we following the policy in the 17th grade? The other grade levels, especially K through 4, we did a great job, I think, of part of but really trying to hold to what their policy states. We've done pretty good in the 5th and 6th grade. It's just that we've not done a good job at all in 7th and 8th grade. We're a bit over at the high school, but not to the extent we are at the school. So that's why that position has been reallocated from 5th grade to 7th grade.
How tight does that make the 5th grade?
Not as tight as the 6th grade.
No, the fifth grade will be 21, 22. The 6th grade is the one that's probably closer to the line because it's 22 or 23. And your policy calls 22 is sort of our circuit breaker, and we start watching it, and we're very careful when it gets closer. So
okay,
we are probably in more jeopardy in grade 6.
Okay, because we've just had so many kids move in all those grades.
That is correct. We have had a thing, and I know already, I know we have 3 new 6th graders coming in, but I don't know who will lead. I mean,
right.
So that's it's a speculation game at this time, and I may have to come to you in late August and say, well, we need help, this is where we are, and here's a couple of different ways to solve the problem. That's the grade level right now, if I was going to speculate, that I think we will be the closest.
And district-wide, the first two items are special education issues. The top one was not something that the district leadership team had on their original list, but after meeting with the finance subcommittee, this was added to the list. The original request was for a full-time social worker. As you know, there are certain limits to the number of students that a social worker needs to be assigned. We're over that. The estimate is that we'll continue to go over that, but the hope is that with the 0.5 or half-time social worker, we should stay in compliance. So this, by cutting this in half, there was also, maybe there was some discussion about having half of that social work position work in regular ed. We do have some issues with social workers, what they're allowed to do as far as where the funding comes from, whether they're going to work with regular ed or special education students. But the short of it is that the feeling is, as far as the mandated special education needs, which are obviously the regular education needs are not mandated, but the mandated special education needs is something that have to social. Because of the IEPs, special education, at Tech, able to do with one less. This is one less from one of the last requests. I think actually there were two less in the original budget. So, and you don't know with that. You could have an IEP of student that require more. So, in this particular year,
we've been told we have a student that's going to be leaving in the end of June, and that student has an adult. So we're gambling.
So if we don't need,
I think it's
okay. Custodial staff, we wanted to move more custodial staff to full-time status. The way we pay, we have been paying some of the school year only to stay on through the summer, is revenue that we are able to generate through rental of the facility. And we've had several different groups. We've had the measured progress, I think, has measured the facility in the past. We've had, the church has rented the facility, and we've been able to generate some revenue to help pay for extra custodial time. We do have a program from Leslie College that started last year, and from what we understand, we'll be continuing to rent the facility this summer. So we do have the revenue for another summer to continue to pay that extra custodial time if we need during the summer through revenue, so we cut that out of the expense side of the budget. We made some cuts in CIP. We really need to begin to work on some of the duct work at the middle school. It's expensive work to get in there, clean those. I won't go through it all, but I need to give you a pretty thorough discussion about that duct work cleaning. If any of you are interested, you can bring them back for another explanation. Suffice it to say, the ducts are dirty, and we need to clean them. Locker room upgrade. We were going to try to do more with the locker room at the middle school. It wasn't part of the original building project, and it's always been something we've been wanting to do for a while, to get in there, do some work with the locker room. But that could be held off for another year. There was a request from the nurses, and they gave you a proposal that where the goal was to have a full-time nurse at each building. Right now we share nurses. We do have techs that work with the nurses, so we do have coverage. We don't have a full-time nurse at each of our buildings. This is becoming more and more important, as you know, with the kinds of kids that are in our schools today, and what nurses do today, and the kinds of things that they do during the course of the day are very sophisticated. So there was a request, and I think we'll see this will come back again. Eventually, I think we're going to test this because more and more problems. There was a request to increase the volunteer coordinator time over what it is right now to full time. And again, this is the year to do that. Sarah had a proposal to award stipends to the CIA team members and also had a way to do some things with people who would, at the building level, would work with professional development. We've had some volunteer team members. I think we're going to get volunteers to continue. They're doing some great work, and they're the ones that have a lot of discussion about the local assessment system and how we listen to curriculum. And hopefully they will continue to do that because it's just the right thing to do without a stipend. So that's the list. And that gets us down to 0.84%, which is a 4.6% reduction. Any other questions?
For the administrators, there are a couple of items here that I'm not really thrilled at having supported the reduction. And I'm hoping to hear from you next year, as Jennifer alluded to, some sort of assessment of the results of not funding these positions. For example, the EdTech 2 Prime Co. Tom, you tell me, they tell us that you've identified roughly 10 students at this point in time that might benefit from this. Well, perhaps within the strictures of confidentiality, you can track those 10 students and give us in numbers next year if in fact some, how many of them were referred to special ed, how many were affirmed as being special ed, different types of things like that, because some of that, forgetting the moral issue, we can attach dollar signs to it. And if necessary, perhaps take another look at it, justifying it not only as morally, but as cost-effective. Same thing, Jeff, in terms of the help center. You know, by reducing your original request for teachers, I'm quite interested in hearing your assessment next year of whether or not, you know, how that center went, if it went, who was served, who was not served, you know, to get a more quantified idea of what's happening. Claire, same thing with your 2005 social worker. How many regular ed students, you know, I'd like to know how many, this time next year, how many regular ed students we could have helped but didn't help. And again, with the, you know, within the confines of confidentiality. But I think we have to do, you know, revisit these. They're particularly near and dear to my heart. So this is just not the year.
Pauline, would you, you also have a new budget sheet that goes over the numbers as far as state revenue changes, property taxes, etc. Could you go over that second sheet?
Right, the second sheet that you have lists the numbers that you had in your workbooks when we met at the end of February. That's the first block of the proposed budget. February 24th, and in the block on the right is the revised numbers with the reductions that we've talked about tonight. So it reduces our expenditure budget to a 9.84% increase in expenditures. We look at the revenues. We have received a subsidy printout from, based on the governor's proposal, and that is going to give it, right now it shows that we will be receiving from the state $54,000 more than last year. So that's a 3.07% increase in the state revenue allocation. When you go down to the computation of tax rate, that will be $1.08 increase in the tax raised for education.
Now the other piece that's, that is still in here, we have the presentation this evening. We don't know where the laptop proposal is going to go. There's a lot of talk that the government very much wants to continue to fund that program for one more year at the state level. So I think that that particular initiative, we can just speculate about what we're going to do. Until we really know what kinds of dollars are attached to, I don't know what sense that makes to go there. Because we have our original proposal in the budget, which was a split on that funding. Then I think we can make some decisions about that when hopefully it will be fairly soon. You know, if the money is coming from the state, then what course of action do we take? If there is no money from the state, then obviously we have to take a course of action. Have that discussion right now, just speculating on the next.
It's still in.
Our original plan of having a shared school parent initiative is still in.
It doesn't account for if the state does not come through at all with laptops.
Right.
The money that's in there is about half of what it would cost us,
right.
Maybe a little less than half. A little more than that.
But if the state comes through,
then there's
that a little
extra. Just preliminary feedback is that we'd be hard pressed, according to our attorneys, to charge parents. No, nothing definite.
You can ask for
donations. I think, you know, because...
Yeah, no, I know that.
But you can ask for donations, but we couldn't, right now, the feeling we could not mandate parents pay with their right to a free education. It's a main constitutional issue.
Any liability issues with the
I don't think so. I think
think it's just dealing with all the issues that we have. It's getting more and more difficult time-wise. I know there are a lot of small schools who are moving that don't have resources. Not in the best shape. We do have coverage, which I think is important. But I do think that better budget here if there was such an animal. I think we need to address that. Just, I think it would feel a lot better with a certified nurse.
Back again to the athletic budget. Under the proposal, we have 3,000 for administrative salaries and benefits, 3,100 out of the 17. So theoretically, that would be the only requirement we would have for that, right?
Say that again.
So he's got 3,149 for administrative salaries and benefits. Is there anything else other than that that we would be required to pay?
Co-curricular.
Coaches pay.
The coaches pay would be the $8,086.
And officials.
And officials.
You have to pay.
So there's, where's that, I'm trying to figure out where that 6,000 is coming out of, from the budget that he gets. There's conference.
I don't have to.
Yeah.
The
what you said was the Nordic, the additional Nordic ski coach. Ninth grade girls basketball, which we don't have to have, and hockey security, and conference and clinics for coaches is what I wrote down, which is what you said.
Yeah. No, hockey security is not an increase in budget. That's an actual cut from the current existing budget, and I think it's the same situation with conferences. So it's not part of the budget request increase, so it doesn't really relate to the 17,000. It relates to the existing budget.
Right, but the big part of the existing budget is just like the teachers and coaches are not getting an increase, negotiated increase in salary. So that's a big part of the increase. Officials, salaries, they would pay. That's something we have to control over. Officials that have been less. That has gone up. So those are the, I think those are the major increases that we're using.
You know, the athletic supplies, things that, you know, usually get cut, you know, first, and equipment replacement, these have declined over this year, that they've declined over the past couple of years. They're down $1,000 from last year, following the $2,200 decrease from the year before. And we're actually increasing the number of participants that, you know, are in the athletic system just because we're increasing, you know, a whole number of high school students. I can see the temptation sometimes when we look at the athletic budget, but I kind of changed my position on it. I mean, I went to several boosters meetings over the course of this year where the parents are now being asked to pay for uniforms for the kids, and it doesn't go across the board in all sports. Some sports may, I'm paying for my child's uniform because they don't have enough of them for the kids, but other teams they are. And I would like to, I'd rather see us either fund all of it or not any of it, you know, and be consistent across all the teams. But right now we're just cutting so narrowly that we're just getting more students participating and we no longer have the equipment. I've heard stories of improper, not enough chest pads for lacrosse, you know, goalies that I'm concerned about that they're not in the budget. And I'm afraid of those types of issues of safety. So I'm not even sure I will cut it to $6,000.
Well, I have a different point of view about the athletics. And I look at, any increase in athletics, I mean, and I hear what you're saying, that we have officials' fees and salaries and et cetera.
But if I look at an increase in athletics, and I'm looking at a cut in teachers, guidance counselors, special ed social workers, and all of those other things that I personally believe are much more intrinsic and valuable to us as an academic school, I have a real tough time with that. I also have a tough time with, right now, you know, we have money in the budget, $17,000 for laptops in terms of paying for half of them, asking for parents to support the other half, which we may not be able to do. But then is the question going to come down to, we're putting more money into athletics, but we may not be able to afford laptops if the state doesn't come through? Somehow, that doesn't sit right with me. And as far as I'm concerned, academics comes first. Athletics is wonderful, and I think it's an enhancement to every student. It is part of their education. But academics is number one. And one piece of interesting information that I came across today, I was going through the files. We had a meeting of a subcommittee for our new superintendent search. And I was going through the files and pulled some information from, if any of you remember, when Ann Chapman was on the school board. And back in 1995, 1996, on a list of things that were problems, discussions, things to look at, was pay for athletics. You know, charge parents some of the fees for athletics. So we have been talking about athletics, and I don't mean we as in all of us, but other boards have been talking about it since 1995 and 1996. And we're still here having those same kind of discussions for the past couple of years.
Well, I disagree with you strongly. Part of our mission is to create well-rounded people, and the number of kids who participate in athletics here is phenomenal. I don't think anybody, I mean, I think physical activity is part and parcel of good academics. A healthy lifestyle, and I guess I'd also question, I mean, in some ways, I think there's a constitutional argument with charging for athletics, but I don't think at this point we're going to go there, for this budget anyway. But I think we still have that free education argument.
Is athletics part of that? I mean, does it come under that? I don't know.
The state constitution reads, insofar as I can remember, having read it, that we need to provide a free education. And what that does is sort of...
I don't know. I think you could make an argument.
Certainly not as clear as, you know, by
textbooks. But so right now, what are we talking about? Are we just talking about supporting this particular athletic budget?
Right, yeah.
I mean, is that what the conversation is really?
I think that our issue is a whole nother budget.
Just so you know, that when the district leadership team met, we went through this, we got this, you know, it wasn't something that we just kind of threw things up on the board. There were some very good discussions about all of these issues, including athletics, and you know, how do we deal with that? Because if you do look at it, supplies and equipment probably going down because it's simplifying less. You know, it comes down to if cuts are going to be made in that area, you know, just federal net program. Charge a fee, and the school systems that have gone that way, Scarborough, they got rid of it because they take care of it. They were hiring people to take care of the fee program. You know, do we go back if you really want to get into athletics? What was the last program? Then it'll be the first out. Just begin, I don't know whether it was high school, cross, whatever it is. The last new program was the first
It's unfair with.
And I'm not endorsing participation fees for athletics. I'm not saying that. I'm just questioning the athletics budget to the total budget.
It comes down.
When things come down to, you know, weighing the difference between this and that, that's my question.
And I agree. I think the priority has to be. The question is balancing all of this and being able to offer the kind of program that this community is used to and do it within the constraints of budgets. Because even with this, even with cutting $406,000, we're going to have to sell this to town council.
I'm thinking that beyond this current budget, I think this is really an issue, this athletic. I mean, clearly there are different opinions on this board, and there are going to be different opinions we'll probably continue. I'm really wondering if we need to take a look at it, like at the beginning of next year. I mean, not take a look at the budget, but take a look at the philosophical issues. And look at how different school districts have really handled it. And so that we can be more proactive when it comes to budget time and say, you know, we had this task force that really evaluated the issue, and we're standing behind how we do it. We want to maintain the sports we have, or whatever we decide. But I mean, I really think that I would like to, I don't know how we make that kind of commitment, to make ourselves put a committee or a task force or something together to really
have a program evaluation of the athletic.
Yeah. But not only our current athletic program, but look at what other school districts are doing and really kind of think about the whole big picture of the percentage of our athletics to our whole budget and the whole
because
thing.
Because what you're, at the meeting in the athletic steering committee, athletic steering committee, there are requests to add more sports.
Right, and so we've really got it sort of come up, you know, philosophically discuss what direction we want our school district to go in with this.
Given choice between not having sufficient funds for laptops, not funding teacher academic positions, athletic goals, and I'm just telling you my opinion, we do not have to charge for athletics. And I'm taking that in terms of Jennifer's constitutional remarks, because I'm sure somebody could make a huge case for that. But engaging a little doublespeak, the budget is up $17,000, and we say that we have to honor that $17,000 because it represents increases in salaries and fees, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, it's up 11,
well,
right?
Well, whatever the number
okay.
is.
Well, it's up 11 now.
We
yes.
do not have to honor anything because of contractual increases. If we keep the budget exactly where it is today, that those increases, contractual increases, come from the existing program, which means effectively we take the existing program, there is no increase in it, and we shift the way we're using the monies. And my answer to eliminating programs is no, you do not eliminate programs. What you do is you take the cost of each sport and you apply the reduction pro rata to all of the sports that currently exist. In other words, ice hockey will be hit higher than any other sport, and it will work its way down till some of the very inexpensive sports will have almost no impact at all. This is just an alternative. I'm not suggesting do it, but this budget is not put to bed yet.
If you do that, what you end up doing is shift the cost to the booster groups, where you have no policy in place as to who's controlling the team anymore. It's no longer the school system, because the booster groups are running the ads, or the coaches, because we don't have enough money to run the ads to find coaches. You have the parents paying for uniforms, you have them picking up equipment, and they're controlling things, and we need to set up, like Ann says, I believe we need to look at the whole department and come up with a set policy on how we're gonna fund all uniforms, or we're gonna charge for all uniforms, but it's gonna be consistent across the board, and we're gonna run this type of ad for this type of position, and it's not gonna allow people to go elsewhere. It's just, to me, it's a bigger issue than just.
But Elaine, we've been asking for that for years. We've been asking to look at athletics, look at the whole program for the past few years.
Well, why haven't we?
Because it just hasn't gotten on the plate.
Okay, but it's, well, then how do we make that kind of, I mean, can we?
Next fall, when you set goals.
Well, I think that we really need to though note now that we want that in our goals for next year's.
Well, I think one of the key things that you said is that some of these major discussions don't need to occur during budget season. They need to start in June or July or August. You know, they need to start at the beginning of the year. You need to know what you're doing before you get to budget season. And I think that's part of the problem. With this, that certainly is part of the problem, because then it just gets, you know, pushed back in the conversation. There's never enough time to have the conversation.
So we'll put that on our agenda first.
You know, that's what the planning committee originally, that was the concept of the planning committee initially. And we were off to a great start. And then after the first year, when all we were looking at were budget numbers that we had to keep cutting, and we could never get to anything that was on our plan, that all got dissolved. So, you know, I'm not saying, it's not anyone's fault that this has happened. We've just been trying to play catch up every year. And unfortunately, what happens is from the time of, Tom, when do you start this budget? In October, November? From that time until right now, that's all you guys think about. That's all you do. You know, and we haven't had those times for initial philosophical kinds of questions and answers prior to that. I mean, have you guys put in more time, less time, or the same time on this budget than you did last year?
Yes.
I mean, because, you know, I just remember, you know, last year, everybody, the conversation was no one focused on anything.
I personally was reaching a point of diminishing returns with it. You have to stop at some point, and you know, I made my presentation about the guidance counselor and then go to sleep. You know, it's out there. We can't keep agonizing about it, I agree.
Yeah,
make it a school board goal. Yeah. Get grip on sports.
Just do it.
Right.
Well, the question though, and is there was a charge from the school board to bring the budget closer to 10%, and we actually got under that. So I think the district leadership team did what was asked. So what we need to know now, and the finance committee, especially about all of these things, and it's not gonna happen. Sometimes it focuses on different areas. They're very well aware. The question now is where do you go with this? How the more people support it, you are, because this needs, you need to have some sort of a, at least around the room, people want this, because we've got to present this and be very
I think, I mean, I definitely would support this budget, and I think everyone's done a wonderful job of cutting back $400,000. I mean, that's a tremendous amount of money, and when I look at the things on this list, like I say, there are, you know, teachers for enrollment issues, there are, social work things, and ed tech positions that I do think that we need, and I do think that down the road, we would possibly suffer for that. So I think everyone's done a wonderful job of getting it to this point, and I'm not happy with an increase of $11,000 in athletics. But for $11,000, am I not going to support this budget? No, I will. But that's my one sticky point. But other than that, I think you guys have done a tremendous job.
I can support this budget. I think that people have gone through it carefully, and the finance committee has looked at it, and I mean, what more can I say? You know, I certainly support it as it is currently presented.
I do support this budget. I supported this budget when the cuts were all $380,000. So the fact that the budget is now cut by $406,000, you have not only met, but exceeded my request. So I have no issue, but I have no issue in being prepared to discuss anything else that needs to be discussed. But this budget I support.
Sure. I looked at this budget, you know, and looked in the subcommittee, and I support the budget, and I think that the administrators have done a really good job on something that we seem to do the same thing. We see the same thing come up every year, and the same things get cut. And it saddens me that we have to do this every year before we even get to town council. And I know we have a gap between what town council wants, and we're gonna have to struggle for that, to show them that they're all things that are needed, and that we did the job that we thought was best, all of us, that we could still meet the needs for all the students. And that's my hope. My gut feeling is that some things are gonna slip through, and that's sad. But at this increase, I'm gonna try as hard as I can to make sure that it goes through as it is.
I was part of the subcommittee as well, we talked about different items, and without trying to micromanage it, because I think that the administrator was the ones that have to do a lot of the work and live through the consequences, and clearly they spend tremendous amount of time putting this all together, and tonight, I will support the budget. I'm not comfortable that when we move forward and present it to the town council, that I think there's a big gap between 8.1 and 9.8, and I'm not saying that because I want to sound like I'm not supporting it, because I want to be supportive, especially as a school board member, but I am concerned about that gap, and I guess it's one of those things we'll have to wait to see how it goes. But I don't know, stick with what we have.
I think the word that I would use to describe this is fair. This is a very fair budget. I looked every single thing that I commented upon at the Saturday budget meeting, and even before that. And then when I was writing down what other people had talked about in previous meetings, this group of administrators addressed everything that was asked to be addressed. And that makes it a fair process. I'm like Elaine and probably others. I would be very much willing to fight for this, because I think this is as bare bones as it can get without sacrificing the integrity of the school system. And I'm not willing to go down that route any further. I think this is a very thorough job, and I am very much understanding what Kathy says about the town council target, but we're in this for the academics, and we also need to defend the integrity of the schools. And as far as I'm concerned, this is where we can go, and this is as far as we can go. And so I will be very, very supportive of this.
I would say, I think the other, I was at Lane, or I think the meeting with the town council set the target of 8.1. But they'd set that target with a lot of information. A piece of information at that time was that the cut from the state would be anywhere from $500,000 to $750,000. So the landscape has changed since we've been given that target. So my hope is that that would be taken into consideration, that even if the governor's proposal doesn't go through, it's like the worst case scenario is to lose 70, anywhere from losing 70 to gaining 54, rather than losing 500 or 750. So I think, you know, obviously, they set that target not just looking at, we only want you to increase X amount. I think that target was set knowing that we're going to lose X amount of dollars also.
But they, but I also heard them say that they had our fixed costs, and they knew what that was going to be with regards to salaries and benefits. I did hear some town councilors who are interested in what that $600,000 of some of this stuff that we've already cut, they wanted to know more details about it. So they, we were at 8.1 with the salary and benefits and the building piece and some special ed costs that we knew were coming up the road. And that's where the 8.1 kind of came in, with the idea that 600,000 they would listen to. They wanted to know, they make some choices, and we made some choices already. But we do need to defend this other 400.
But I still think it,
yeah.
So, but you still make, my guess is that you can't ignore the fact that the funding issue isn't as bad as the other.
No,
and
that certainly would be. It was a goal. At this point, we would have the budget set up exactly as it was presented here. We go to town council for them. Like,
we will make we'll make some revisions to your budget book. For instance, some of the figures in those first few pages. My overview, the numbers are going to have to change. And so we'll give you the updated pages for your books so that they'll be the same as the council's books when they get their budget books. So that will be up to them.
And this goes to the town council on the 31st, next Wednesday, correct?
Yes, and then you will adopt it at your next regular scheduled school.
We will adopt it on the 13th. And then when do we review it with the town council? On the 14th? Is that the 14th?
I think so. But so could I ask one question? If you're going to be revising these budget, you'll take up the middle column, and if you're going to be putting those in, I would ask, as I had mentioned before to Pauline and the school board, that this effect on the average homeowner is not accurate, in that the average, the median home value in Cape Elizabeth is no longer 200,000, it's 279,000. So the increase of $215.87 that's shown as the effect on an average homeowner is understated quite significantly. It's really over $300 increase. So I would ask that since that is indeed, and $279,000 is indeed an accurate median figure.
The other way we can do that, we talked about, is once we get, because who's an average homeowner? I mean, would it make more sense to the effect on the home guide for every $100,000 it's taxable?
You could certainly do that if you wanted to provide that additional.
Not to say that the average home is.
But the average, using the English sense, really what it's always meant before, in the past 4 years that I've been on the council and that some of you have been on the school board, has been the median. And the median 3 years ago was $180,000 home, and that's what Pauline had always calculated those numbers at. Last year it was $200,000 before the revaluation. Now, after the revaluation, the median home is $279,000 in Cape Elizabeth, which means half the homes are above it in value and half the homes are below it. So the real impact of property tax for education will be an increase of over $3,200, which is in, and it, the effect is over 300, the impact is over 300. So I would just ask that that's the way the council will be looking for it, because that's the way it's always been done on the median. If you want to provide additional information on, you know, a house at $100,000, although I don't think there are too many of those in Cape Elizabeth, 200, 300, 400, whatever.
For every $100,000 in value.
You could do that, but I would ask, even if you do that, if you could do it for $279,000, that's sort of the average.
So
homeowner in Cape Elizabeth these days.
Median's more accurate.
The median, yes, it's, we've always called it average, but it's sort of in the way you're talking about an average person. It's the median homeowner, so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments, questions from anyone?